There's nothing that I lack. He lets me rest easy and leads a long right path. It's all for his name's sake and for his glory. Even when I go through the darkest valley, I will feel.
Well, good morning, everybody. Please find a seat. We're going to begin our service. As you know, we like to begin now 5 minutes of the hour so we can talk about announcements to be made so that we don't run too far over our worship experience. If you look into your bulletin, you will see at the end notes, well, maybe you don't have it, just me, but let me go quickly through these. There is child care available this morning. Sunday school is at 10:15. There is a Bible study with the pastor every Wednesday at 1 o'clock. We will be saying today the Apostles' Creed, which maybe you haven't said for a while, but we'll be starting today to be saying it. Next Sunday is Reformation Sunday. How many of you know about Reformation Sunday? Good, then I can say anything I want. Very good. Reformation Sunday. Now we're considering a service for the blessing of the animals. In the church sanctuary, it'll be conducted outside. You can bring your pets, your dogs, your cats, whatever you have that you like to see blessed. Cows and horses, not so much, but we'll come to your farm to do that if you'd like to have that done. So I'm just this morning wanting to get a sense that if we had a blessing of the animals, how many of you might be interested? Show of hands, please. And it doesn't mean to bring your mother-in-law or your father-in-law. So just a few of you would be interested. Okay. But Tim Huggins and myself, we may have this. And if we do, it'll probably be around Easter time, the blessing of the animal service. It would not take much time. For the actual service, and we'd go from animal to animal. Okay, let's hear a little bit about the Reformed Church in America and General Synod that has concluded this week. My wife, Karen, has elected to share with us some of the highlights. Not a lot, just the highlights of it. And Mrs. Faulkner, there you are.
For the past couple of weeks, we have been praying for General Synod before they went into session, while they were in session. And this week, General Synod ended, And I just have a couple General Synod 2021 issues that were discussed. And all of these issues will be addressed over the next few years because there's a lot of details to be worked out. But there is one that we can have an immediate response to, and all people, not just churches, but all people, and that is the issue number one. General Synod took action on creation care in response to climate change. We share a deep love for all of God's creation and prioritize a profound responsibility for it, urging RCA institutions, congregations, and individual members to take immediate steps in reducing fuel consumption and transition to a renewable energy. So each of us need to monitor our energy use so that we can.
Okay, Linda? That's the one?
Do this in a positive way.
Okay.
Issue number two, there will be a new team to develop a restructuring plan for the RCA. They will be preparing churches who remain in the RCA for a healthy and sustainable ministry. And this will be done over a number of years. On issue number three, there is new regulations adopted for departing churches. There were 10 pages of regulations, so we won't get into any details. So, but the one thing we can say is that churches that do decide to go this route will be able to retain their properties. Now, if you would like more information, go to the RCA website under General Synod, and you can find more issues that were discussed and more details on some of these. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Any more announcements? Yes.
Good morning.
Morning.
Something's been happening in the back of our church every week. Something's been happening in the back of our church all year. It's been very subtle. Some of you probably did notice it. Some of you may have not. But each month, the mission committee has been collecting items for our annual drive to collect Samaritan shoeboxes. If any of you aren't aware of what they are or what they do, please don't be afraid to either see me, my daughter Nicole, or anybody on the mission committee. I think most of us are aware, but I just want to bring it to your attention again because we really haven't really been talking about it, and I think it's at this point we need to. So. Samaritan Purse collects Christmas shoe boxes that we fill with school supplies, hygiene products, toys, and little trinkets that go all over the world to children who don't know about Jesus Christ. In these shoe boxes, besides what we add, they also add some literature for the kids to learn about Jesus, and each village that receives these shoe boxes will have some sort of a class where the children can attend, actually learn about the gospel. It's like a 12-week sort of class that they go to. And when they graduate, they receive a Bible in their own language. This program has been a part of my family since my kids were tiny. We used to just make our four little shoe boxes at home. And then when my daughter went to college, the Christian club there did the shoe boxes. And we've been doing it in Sunday school for quite some time. And then a few years ago, we turned it into a whole congregation-wide event. So I just want to talk to you about what we're doing, okay? So two of the products that they ask to put in the shoe boxes are school supplies, okay? This notebook I got at Walmart for 25 cents. These pencils cost a dime each. So for 45 cents, we're not sending a child a notebook and two pencils. We're sending them the chance to go to school because in a lot of these villages, if they don't have their own paper and pencils, they are not allowed to attend. So don't think of it as just the material things. You're changing these kids' lives. So the reason I'm talking to you about it today is because each shoebox costs $9 to ship. We, Bellevue Reformed Church, make sure that every one of our The mission committee, Christian Ned, the well, they all contribute to the postage. But we also like to put it out there that if anyone would like to donate to the shipping, it does help defer the cost. Again, it costs $9 to deliver one of these boxes. That $9 is the postage and the whole class that the kids can attend to and the gospel information they put in the box. Please, this box, it's going to be the best $9 you're going to spend. And do not think that if you couldn't make a whole shoebox on Hanging of the Greens, we are going to give everybody a chance to pack their own box. If you backed them with your families, you can bring them in that day. They'll be blessed, and then they'll be delivered to the drop-off point. So if you have any questions about this whole thing, don't hesitate to ask. And just to let you all know that this is one way that we're changing the lives of children that don't live where we live. Thank you.
Does everybody know who you are? Okay. I'm still learning. I can't support this strongly enough. It's a great project, and you are a blessing to this congregation to share with us this mission. Okay. Let us worship God. We are gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And as this Christ candle is lit, we praise God for the opportunity to worship together and to feel His holy presence. Amen. Amen.
Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him.
Be sure to go up to this mini preacher and thank her for coming before all of us and sharing with us the Word of God. It takes courage at that age or at any age to come before people and speak. And here she is speaking. Thank you very much. Let us sing our first hymn, Morning Has Broken. Beautiful.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wedding garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's all play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word.
Please be seated. It's a beautiful hymn expressing gratitude to God for the new day. It's a recreation, a new day to fellowship with God, to be inspired by God, to see life anew. It's a beautiful hymn that we can all take to heart. Morning has broken. This morning has broken. We are come together to hear God's word anew, afresh, and to find the inspiration from it that the Lord wants all of us to have so that we can walk more nearly in his steps and find the joy that there is in life amidst the heartache. God offers us an opportunity to be renewed by shaking off the shackles of that which we do, which is not helpful to the growth of our faith, that is not helpful to relationships and being the reconcilers of relationships that we are called to be. And in some ways, we could improve living this life. We could improve it in the way so that we can see God more clearly, see how God operates in our life and in other lives and in this world itself. So let us come together in our prayer of confession, asking God to cleanse us from those words and deeds and thoughts that we pursue that is injurious to our spiritual growth and our witnessing to the Lord. Please join me in our prayer, followed by silent reflection, and then asking Lord's mercy upon us, and then the words of assurance, and then almost we can spring out of our seats and we can thank God for our forgiveness of sins. Thank God. And then the summary of the Lord to guide us. And then our wonderful children and their message. So let's now speak to the Lord intimately. Let us pray. Gracious God, sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear. Set us free from a past that we cannot change, and open us to a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Amen. Fellow Christians, rejoice and be glad. As the scriptures tell us, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Believe this. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ Jesus. Our sins are forgiven. Praise be to God. Let us arise and sing the Gloria together.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Whiter than snow we are at this very moment. Thank you, Lord. And as we go forward now in our lives, we remember before us God's word to us through Jesus Christ, that we are to love him with our heart, with our mind and our soul, our complete being. It's who we are. We love him completely and totally, and we show this by loving our neighbor, whoever that might be, as much as we love ourselves. Upon these two commandments depend all of life, depend all the law. May we live by it. Amen. Children.
Okay. Oh, you brought your baby too. Hi, hi, hi. Good morning, everybody. We brought our babies today. Okay. Well, before I begin, I had a phone call last night from Monica. And Tim, do you still have a chair at your house that needs to be delivered? So I guess we're looking for a strong back and a truck to help deliver a chair, heavy chair, from Tim Huggett's house to Monica's house for her mom. So if anybody thinks they can do that or might want to help, please talk to Tim. That was my shameless plug. Okay, do you want to have a seat with everybody else, please? Oh, look, we have a baby. Well, he's not really a baby anymore. We've got some big kids. Okay, so this is my baby. Her name is, what's her name again?
Mercedes.
Her name is Mercedes, and she's going to help me today. Now, I do happen to spend a lot of time with a real baby, and I know for a fact that babies are not shy. They are not afraid to tell you what they need. Now, babies don't use words. How do they tell you when they need something? What do?
Like whining.
Whining? Crying, maybe? Crying? Do babies cry when they're hungry? No? Sometimes they do. Do they cry when they're tired? Or maybe when they don't feel good? Or maybe when they just want their mommies? Right, Noah? So good to see everybody today. Hi. Do you want to hold my baby for me? Okay, you can take care of my baby. All right. Do you want to sit with everybody else? Okay, so babies are not shy to ask for what they want. Now, as we get a little older, sometimes we don't cry every time we want something. Sometimes we don't even ask for something that we need as we get older. But God really wants us to talk to him and ask him for what we really need. Now, back in the Bible days, there was a man. Actually, Jesus was walking into a town, or leaving a town called Jericho, and the blind man named Bartimaeus was sitting on the side of the road. I just want to break out into song, and if you know the song about the blind man sitting on the road, you're with me. Anyways, he cried, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." His crying out was very disturbing to all the people around him. "Be quiet," they yelled at him, but he only shouted louder. This reminds me of the last time I was up here talking about when the kids were wanting to see Jesus, and they said, "Be quiet, be quiet." Well, Jesus heard Bartimaeus crying out, and he stopped and said, "Tell him to come to me." So Bartimaeus jumped up, threw aside his coat, and went to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked. "I want to see," Bartimaeus said. "Go," Jesus said. "Your faith has healed you." And instantly Bartimaeus could see, and he followed Jesus down the road. Like a mother who does whatever she wants to take care of her baby, God knows exactly what we need, and he wants what is best for us. So, in the Bible, in Philippians, it says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. That's how we're going to tell God what you need and thank him for what he does for us. And I know at the end of the day, when I have my little baby and she starts crying, I know exactly what she needs. She needs her mother. She just wants her mother to hold her and cuddle with her. And you know what? Sometimes that's what we need from God. We just want him to hold us and reassure us that everything's going to be okay. So, whatever you need in life, speak up, don't be shy, talk to Jesus, and he will give you what you need. So let's pray about that, and then we'll go to our classes and we'll talk some more about this. Heavenly Father, we know that you love your children and want what's best for them. Help us remember we don't need to worry about anything. All we need to do is speak up and ask you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, everybody.
Now, before you all go, stay where you are.
Please talk.
Thank you, Laura. We have some wonderful news. Linda, would you like to share this with us and your daughter and everybody? Here you go. Stand right up and look around. And
so I wanted to let everybody know that Noah went to the cardiologist last week, and he has clearance to be around kids his own age. Mm-hmm. And younger, so he can get used to being around them so that he'll be able to go to preschool. Right?
And I want to thank everyone for their prayers and the prayer blanket you made for him with his surgery and everything. It's so appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay. All right, we're good?
Good. Okay. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Wonderful news. It's wonderful to hear the sounds of children going to their classes. And now it's for us to arise and to state what we believe to be the truth of our faith. Please, the Apostles' Creed. Do you all have a copy, or is there a copy coming up? Okay. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and seateth on the right hand. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. The resurrection, I believe, the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Kind of jumped around there, but next week we'll get it. I often will pray the old Apostles' Creed. When I say old, it's just a few different words that are changed. Without thinking, that's what I go to often. So, but next week, we'll have it better. Now I shall go upstairs. The reading for this morning will be taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, beginning to read 11 through 19. Let us pray, please. Our Father in heaven, may these not just be mere words that we are reciting, but may they be the bread of life for us. And we take them in and savor them and learn from them. Amen. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back. Praising God with a loud voice, he prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." Here ends the reading of the Lord's word. May it make us well as well. Let's look at this scripture a little more closely and gather some understanding. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He's leaving his Galilean ministry, where it's his beginning, where he's teaching, parables are being spoken, miracles are happening. And he's moving now to his Jerusalem ministry. It's where he is going to die. for you, for myself. He's in transition. And so it says, on the way, you could even read it as it comes to me, on the way to his death, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. The reason he's doing that is because it would have been easier for him to go through Samaria. But the Samaritans were, let's just say they did not like the Jews, and the Jews did not like them for a variety of reasons, ethnicity and religion, and you know, they weren't Jewish. And so they were foreigners, people who did not know God, so it was thought, people who did not worship the true God. And so as he was going in between Galilee and Samaria, he came upon this village. Now, according to the Jewish law, anyone who was a leopard, and the term leopard was a broader category that embraced several different types of diseases. And as they approached this village, the leopards, who were not allowed to be anywhere in the village because of their condition, and they could not approach anybody closely, they had to stay away, and I forget how many feet it was, but quite a few, not just two. They came, and instead of saying unclean, unclean, which was what they were supposed to say, to notify the others to stay away, they petitioned Jesus in this way. So they must have heard of him. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when Jesus saw this in their condition, he had mercy on them. And he said to them, go and show yourself to the priest, which was, according to Jewish law, what you needed to do in order to be declared clean. There was a ritual to go through to be declared, yes, indeed, you are clean. You may reintegrate into society. And as they were going to the priest, the one, interestingly enough, who was not Jewish, but who was a foreigner, stopped. And he turned around, having found himself to be healed. And as it said, and it makes a point of saying this, he came back, yes, praising God with a loud voice. That's significant. This man who was not supposed to know God because he wasn't Jewish, he came back praising God with a loud voice, and he threw himself or laid before Jesus' feet, prostrated himself, and thanked Jesus. Now, it seems here that what we have is a showing of the compassion of God through Jesus Christ by healing all 10. And the reality that 9 of them who did not show any gratitude, any thanksgiving, they were still healed. And they went on their way, presumably. We know not, but presumably they did, without coming back to Jesus and saying, thank you, thank you, thank you. Praise God. But the one person who was not Jewish, a foreigner, did. And he comes back and he thanks God, showing that God heals those who are outside of the Jewish family, outside of Christianity. God heals who God will heal. But the major difference is this, and I pray it doesn't get lost on us. And the recognition of this Samaritan that he was healed, he got something that the others did not. He got to commune with Jesus. He came back face to face and commune, interacted, experienced, was a part of, in the presence of Jesus. Life, redemption, redeemed. He recognized that and he received it. The other ones never got to know Jesus. They just took their blessing for granted, so it appears. They never got to know Jesus. When we express gratitude, when we identify what it is we are grateful for and we are thankful to God, there is an experience of closeness to God, experience of new life, a rebirth. Morning is broken, recreation. And the more that we become aware and identify what we have to be thankful for and express it, the more we feel the abundance of the Spirit, the abundance of the Spirit of God in our lives. And it changes us. It changes our personality. It changes our attitude. You know, salvation of itself is encouragement. We often think of salvation, I'm saved. That's so narcissistic. I am saved. Faith has done this for me. I am saved. Look at it differently. Salvation. The purpose of it is to encourage us to love as God loves. Think of that. Salvation is meant, our experience of salvation is meant for us to love as God loves us. That's a beautiful way of thinking of salvation. It's encouragement. Brings gratitude, which is the centerpiece of our faith. Gratitude to God. Fingers not pointed at us, it's at God. Thank you, Lord, as I grow in wisdom and in stature in your favor. And the three things that I pray for each day in my growth and development as a person who sees you and thanks you is to see you more clearly, to love you more dearly, and to follow you more nearly, day by day, day by day. It has a miraculous effect on our personality, how people experience us and how we experience them. And it has an effect on corporate people. When people come together, when groups come together, you can pretty well sense, I think, those who live in a life of gratitude, that when they get out of bed in the morning and their feet touch the ground, they say, "Thank you, Lord. I've taken it for granted for so many years, not this morning. Thank you that I can get up. I can walk. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I can go to my refrigerator, open it up, and eat pretty much what I'd like. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I can put clothes on that will keep me warm today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I can come to my church family and sit amongst them and see them or experience them and feel them. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I have mission work to do, Lord. Thank you. That is my purpose do mission work on behalf of you. Thank you, Lord. So, what does a attitude of gratitude look like in this congregation? Well, let's look at visitors. When visitors come in, are they welcomed here? Do you see them as people who have the opportunity to experience and embrace God in a worship service as you do? Or do you stand off, stand away? You don't talk to them. You don't say hi. You don't acknowledge them. How about leadership? Are you encouraging of your leaders? Or are you just critical of them? Just critical, not encouraging. How about differences between us? Do you accept them and seeing them as a part of the tapestry of life, human life? Or are you judgmental, judging them? Education. Do you feel like you never have enough education? In this case, in Scripture. Or do you have better things to do with your time? Now, it was, used to be often said the only time that the Bible gets brought out and dusted off is when the preacher's coming over to make a visit. I hope that's not true here. Involvement. Yes, an attitude of gratitude is, yes, I want to be involved as best that I'm able to be involved in whatever way that looks. Or is it that let somebody else do it? I paid my dues here. I just don't want to do it. I got other things. How about purpose in your life? Do you see that your life is meant to be, that you have a story to tell? A story of faith, of hope. Gratitude. And what is your self-view? That you are a can-do person in the faith? Or that you're a can't-do person in the faith? Your attitude is a reflection of your gratitude, which maybe I'm too bold to suggest this, but maybe this is something for all of us to work on. It's so easy to take things for granted until we don't have them anymore. And then we realize just how important they are. I think older people have a greater sense of that than younger people. It's not that younger people are ignorant, it's just that they're younger. And older people are losing things. And they realize just how important they were to them. But in losing things, it heightens our ability to draw ever closer to God, who remains the same. That God's grace will never change. God's presence will only be increased if forgiveness is unconditional. These are things from God that never changes, and that you have a home, I have a home, we have a home with God. We're just on a journey to a greater presence of God. We're on that journey. Some of us will get there sooner than others, but we will get there, and one day we will be together. So, dear friends, I would bring this message to a conclusion in remembering our first hymn that I did not choose. It just was there, and how appropriate it is. Morning has broken, God's recreation of a new day. The birds are singing, we shall follow in his footsteps. Because we are looking for things that we have that we can be thankful for. It's our gratitude. Let us grow in wisdom. Let us grow in wisdom. Let us grow in our appreciation of God's work in us and around us, and come with a loud voice praising him. Thank you. Thank you. And let it be seen in our lives. May it be so with each and every one of us. We have much to be thankful for. Amen. Our Father in heaven, we are grateful that we have a faith. We are grateful that we have wonderful leaders in this congregation who guide us, who direct us, who give us hope. We are thankful, Lord, that we have committed people who go out of their way to bring your message to us. We are very thankful for that. Thank you for your word, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, just before I go into the prayer of thanksgiving and intercession, I want to say that I sat amongst the consistory this past Tuesday night, and I was very impressed with the leadership that was provided. I was very impressed by those who were there and the reports that they gave. Under Pat's careful leadership, the meeting moved along, covering all the bases, and the careful reports that were given were concise and right to the point. The time for creative thinking was managed very well. I was very impressed. I've seen a lot of meetings in my life, so much so I don't want to be a part of meetings anymore. No offense, please. This one reflected upon you so very well. I am delighted to recommend you to any person that I meet, clergy, who would be interested in coming, in moving. The other committees that I have attended, I would say the same thing for us, for. They're active, they're alive, they're involved. They just don't let one person do everything. They speak. You have so much to be thankful for. You have much going on right now. You heard the words at the beginning of our church about your mission in the box ministry. That's very important. You have people like that who are involved in doing, representing your faith so very well. So, dear friends, it's good to look to the past and say, what? Thank you, Lord. It's wonderful to look to the presence and say, thank you, Lord. And it's exciting to look to the future, which you have, and say, thank you, Lord. I hope you are excited about yourselves, your ministry, this congregation, this church, as I think you ought to be. I've been in much larger churches that do much less, that put all the weight of ministry on just a few people, and they can't be bothered to get more involved, because they have so many more important things to do. You're not like that. Please join me in prayer. How good it is to say to you, Lord, 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 Savior, Savior. It means so very much to each and every one of us. We commend to you, Lord, people who have submitted cards. We want to say thank you, Lord, for the good news of Noah. My, my. How joyful it is for Noah's mom, Noah's grandma, to all people. We thank you. We thank you for the leaders of this church that you have blessed us with. We thank you for the parishioners of this church that you have blessed us with. We thank you for this sanctuary that you've blessed us with. Father, we bring to your attention Sandy's son, Thomas, who is out of the hospital, at home, recuperating. He's in some pain, discomfort, but he's at home and he's recuperating. We pray for continued movement in the healing process. We also pray, Father, for Glendia, I'm not pronouncing that right, that she's not feeling well and she hasn't felt well for some time. And we pray, Father, that the doctors will find some Glinda, yeah, I got it now, that they will find what the problem is and begin to make movement towards healing her. She's not been feeling well for quite some time. So we bring her to your attention. Which, Father, we really don't have to bring her to your attention. You are already watching over her. But we bring our concern, as we do Michael. No one in this congregation knows Michael. He is a personal friend of Karen and ours, living in Portland, Oregon, who's become critically ill. And we know that he's in your loving embrace. And our wish, Father, is that he would find healing and restoration in his life. And we bring him to you. We bring Wendy to you, Father, who has a lot of pain in her hips, that there would be a healing for her this day, that her hips will feel better as the day goes on. We bring Wendy to you in our prayers. And so, Father, in this moment of silence, we bring to you other people that we know who are in need of prayer. Father, the joy here is knowing that whomever we have forgotten, you have not. These dear people that we love and care for, they're in your care. Our wish is that they'd all be healed and they'd all live a healthy and wonderful life. That is our wish. But we entrust the future as we do the present into your loving embrace. All works well for those who put their trust in you. So, dear Father, give us courage to go on, continue praying, thinking of you, and being in gratitude. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray this in the prayer that you have taught us. Whenever we speak to you intimately by praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn is, they will know us by that we are Christians.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
I want to thank you for your music. You show us how much you love us by leading us in music. And we could never sing as beautifully as we do without your leadership. Thank you for the time you give and the love you show us. Now, friends, dear friends, go forth in your faith, in the joy of knowing God intimately. Go in peace. Amen.